مجموع الفتاوى عقيدة الواسطية. This is an اعتصام لسان العرب. The true creed of our pious predecessors regarding these صفات is تفريض المعنى ونفي الكيف. To leave the meaning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to deny modality and the howness. Sheikh Fawzan حفظه الله, he has also mentioned the same thing as Sheikh bin Baz رحمه الله, that nowhere in the Quran and Hadith has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam denied a body or appearance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala, he has mentioned in his Al-Fatwa Al-Hamawiyyat Al-Kubra, page 79, this is the site title, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with us literally and he is on the earth literally. So what is the fatwa regarding this? These sifat we cannot take in the literal meaning, because if we take these sifat in the literal meaning, automatically a person will form a body for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam Razi rahimahullah has mentioned that a mujassim, he never worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because he only worshipped the surah and the appearance inside his brain, and Allah is free from the surah and appearance. And that this is the most authentic opinion, that Allah is literally face everywhere. Now you tell me, isn't this worse than the layman who said Allah is everywhere? الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونصلي ونسلم على رسوله الكريم أما بعد. My dear respected brothers and sisters and honorable listeners, today inshallah ta'ala the topic which we will like to discuss is regarding the true creed and aqeedah of our pious predecessors, the Salaf al-Salihin. And the area which I would like to cover today in particular is regarding the sifat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Regarding the attributes of Allah, which includes the yad, the hand of Allah, if you would like to translate it into English, the saq, the shin of Allah, ayn, the eye of Allah. These attributes come under the sifat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And inshallah we'll also discuss regarding the istiwa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being above the throne, what does this mean? And what is the true creed of the Salaf? But before going into the actual topic, as an introduction I would like to mention that sifat, the attributes of Allah, there are three types. Attributes of Allah, there are three types. One is al-sifat al-aqliyya. Al-sifat aqliyya. I.e. those sifat, those attributes which a person through his intellect he can believe and acknowledge. Like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being qadir, the all power. Like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being sami', he can listen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is basir, the all seeing. So these are attributes which are related to our aql, our intellect. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our ilah, he's our Lord, he has to have these qualities. And our intellect accepts that ilah, that Allah, who is the sustainer of the heavens and the earth, he has to be qadir. He cannot be ajiz. He cannot be hopeless. He has to be sami'. He has to be the one that can listen. He cannot be deaf. So on and so forth. Similarly, we have attributes like al-sifat al-khabriya. Al-sifat al-khabriya. Al-sifat al-khabriya, i.e. those sifat, those attributes which the intellect cannot understand, but they have been mentioned in the Quran and Ahadith. Like the hand of Allah. Or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being above the throne. Or the shin of Allah. Or the foot of Allah. These sifat, they cannot be understood through intellect. Why? Because a person cannot imagine Allah with the foot, Allah with the hand. But because these sifat are mentioned in the Quran Ahadith, thus they are called al-sifat al-khabriya. Similarly, the third type you have al-sifat al-ma'nawiyya. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala laughing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being angry. So these are the three main types of sifat. But our main discussion today, which inshallah ta'ala will be explained in great detail, is regarding al-sifat al-khabriya, those sifat that have come inside the Quran and ahadith and cannot be understood through intellect, like the hand of Allah, the foot of Allah, the shin of Allah, Allah being above his throne. But before I go into the discussion, I would like to make one thing very clear, inshallah ta'ala, that upon this Quran ayats, sunnah rasul, ijma' of the ummah, and quotes from eminent scholars will be given, inshallah, to prove this. The true creed of the Salaf, the true creed of our pious predecessors regarding these sifat, khabriya, hand of Allah, the shin of Allah, the eye of Allah, is tafwidhul ma'na wa nafyul kayf. Tafwidhul ma'na wa nafyul kayf. Tafwidhul ma'na, i.e. to consign the meaning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To consign the meaning to Allah. To relegate the meaning to Allah, to leave the meaning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wa nafyul kayf, and to deny modality and the howness. This is the true creed of the Salaf. For example, the word yad, the hand of Allah, the true creed of the Salaf is that the meaning to this Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. And the howness and the modality that can be derived, we deny this, the nafyul kayf. This is the aqeedah of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, of the sahaba, a'imma arba, the muhaddithun, the fuqaha, the mufassirun, the mutakallimun, and the nuzar, from Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, all the way to ulama'i Deoband. This is the aqeedah. And inshallah ta'ala, on this copious, overwhelming inshallah evidences will be given. And hopefully, bihamdillahi ta'ala, no doubt will remain inshallah ta'ala.
Inshallah.
First, I would like to mention, what does tafwid al-ma'na mean? What does it mean to leave the meaning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? This I have in front of me. One of the best books, dictionaries in the Arabic language, Lisan al-Arab. Lisan al-Arab, written by Imam al-Allama ibn Mandur, rahimahullah ta'ala. In here, under the word tafwid, he has mentioned, the tafweed means sayyarahu ilayhi wa ja'alahu al-hakim fihi. To leave a matter with somebody else. To make him hakim regarding that matter. To make him the judge. Like Allah says in the Quran, wa ufawwidhu amri ila Allah. That I surrender my matter to Allah. This ayat is in the Quran. Wa ufawwidhu amri ila Allah. I surrender my matter to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So regarding the sifat, the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the khabariyya, those sifat that are derived through the Quran and hadith, like the hand, the foot, the eye, etc. Our aqeedah is tafwid al-ma'na, that we surrender the meaning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We relegate and consign the meaning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is what tafwid means, to surrender something to somebody, and to make him the hakim and the judge regarding that thing. So our aqidah in this is that we leave the meaning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We make him the hakim, who is khayrul hakimin, the best of all judges. But we accept the words also. We accept the words to be true. The sifat khabriya, we accept the words to be true and haq from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but the meaning we consign to Allah and the modality and howness we deny. This is our aqeedah. We have a group, a minority, in this day and age, who claim that the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are known. The attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are known. For example, the word yad, the meaning is known. We establish the meaning. The ayn, the eye of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we establish the meaning. Saq, the shin of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we establish the meaning. However, we say that the modality and the howness is majhool, is not known. This is their aqeedah. And the strange thing about this whole issue is that these people claim this is the aqeedah of the Salaf and they project this false aqeedah onto the Salaf. So many people are in this misconception that this aqeedah which they propagate within the ummah today is the true aqeedah of the sahaba and the true aqeedah of the a'imah. This is absolutely false. This aqeedah is not the aqeedah of the salaf. This aqeedah was pioneered by Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala. Imam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, I have to make one thing very clear. Imam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, Hafiz Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah, these ulama we respect. We give them all due respect because of their knowledge, because of their status inside the deen. But when it comes to some issues related with aqaid, they have stumbled in many places and the ulama of the time and after have made the ummah aware of this. Imam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, regarding tafwid, which is the true creed of the scholars and the pious predecessors, he has said in his Dar'u Ta'arud al-Naql, in volume 1, page 25, 205, sorry, that tafweed, i.e. to consign the meaning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this aqeedah is min sharri aqwal al-bid'ah wal ilhad, that this is the most worst statements of the Ahl al-Bid'ah and those people who are heretics. This is what Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah has mentioned regarding the true creed of the Salaf. My brothers, we have to remember that in these sifat we cannot take the literal meaning. For example, taking the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the literal meaning, taking the eye of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the literal meaning, these sifat we cannot take in the literal meaning. Because if we take these sifat in the literal meaning, automatically a person will form a body for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why many people taking these sifat in the literal meaning, they have fallen inside anthropomorphism. They have fallen inside anthropomorphism, i.e. to describe human qualities to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One important thing which I would like to mention before moving forward is that these sifat, the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the eye of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being above the throne, Allah being above the throne, these sifat are from the mutashabihat, the ambiguous verses. Ambiguous verses. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned in the Quran regarding the two types of verses. There's one the muhkam, which are clear cut, and the second are mutashabihat, which are ambiguous. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, هو الذي أنزل عليك الكتاب منه آيات محكمات هن أم الكتاب وأخر متشابهات. It was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who revealed to you the book which contains muhkamat, which are clear and they're not ambiguous. And these are the mother, these are the essence of the Quran. And the other verses are ambiguous. فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ زَيْغٌ. As for those who have crookedness in their hearts, they go and they try to interpret the mutashabihat. So these are the mutashabihat. Mutashabihat which Allah has mentioned that they're ambiguous. Why are they ambiguous? Because when you say the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, automatically every single dictionary in the world, if we pick up the word hand, it refers to a body limb which is made of blood and flesh. So when you say hand, a human has got hand. Regarding Allah, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِي شَيْءٍ. There's nothing like Allah. So Allah is free from these things. So there's a mutashab. Ambiguity has been created. So that's why these verses are ambiguous. Thus, Imam Ibn Rajab Al-Hanbali rahimahullah has mentioned in his famous book, اِخْتِيَارُ الْأَوْلَى فِي شَرْحِ حَدِيثِ اِخْتِصَامِ الْمَلَئِ الْأَعْلَى, on page 40-41, that the verses related with sifat Al-Khabriya, the eye of Allah, Allah being above the throne, the shin of Allah, these are from the mutashabihat. These are from the mutashabihat. These are from the ambiguous verses. Similarly, Allama Ibn Qudama Al-Hanbali rahimahullah has mentioned in his kitab, in his book, Rawdatul Nadir wa Jannatul Manadir, that the sifat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the sifat Khabriya, are related and they are from the mutashabihat. And he gives examples. Like الرحمن على الأرش استوى بل يداه مبسوطتان لما خلقت بيدي ويبقى وجه ربك تجري بأعيننا, where the throne of Allah has been mentioned, where the eye of Allah has been mentioned, where the wajh and the face of Allah has been mentioned, so on and so forth. So these are the mutashabihat. Now if a person's got aqidah and he's got a creed, he has to give evidence which is muhkam, which is clear cut. He cannot give evidence which has ambiguity or vagueness inside. To prove an aqidah, those brothers who want to prove aqidah, if they want to prove aqidah, they have to give those Quranic verses or those ahadith which are clear cut and they don't have no ambiguity and they don't have no vagueness. I have in front of me Imam Shafi'i rahmatullahi alayhi al-i'tisam. This is al-i'tisam of Imam Shafi'i rahmatullahi alayhi, Darul Hadith al-Qahira. Imam Shafi'i rahmatullahi alayhi, many scholars are saying, yeah, mashallah, they will know, he has a very high status in Qiraat. Those students who study the seven ways of reading the Quran, the Qiraat, Ashara, the 10 ways, they study his book Shatbiyah. He's a very great scholar, a renowned scholar. He has mentioned under the chapter of the principles of the Ahli Bidah on page 170 that وَقَدْ عَلِمَ الْعُلَمَاءِ, that the ulama have known أَنَّ كُلَّ دَلِيلٍ فِيهِ اشْتِبَاهٌ وَإِشْكَالٌ لَيْسَ بِدَلِيلٍ فِي الْحَقِيقَةِ, that every evidence which has vagueness and ambiguity is not evidence in reality. Every evidence which has vagueness and ambiguity, it is not evidence in reality. He further mentions that for sifat to prove this, to prove any aqidah, we need to give clear-cut muhkam verses. We cannot give mutashabihat. We cannot give ambiguous verses like the hand of Allah, Allah being above the throne. And he says this is the reality. فَمَنْ عَكَسَ الْأَمَرَ, whoever does contrary to this matter, حَاوَلَ الشَّتَطًا, he has crossed limits. Then he mentions, وَدَخَلَ فِي حُكْمِ الْذَمْ, he has entered in the ruling of being blamed and being criticized. Why? لِأَنَّ مُتَّبِعَ الشُبَهَاتِ مَذْمُومٌ, he says that going after shubahat, like Allah has mentioned in the Quran, that many verses are mutashabihat, ambiguous, even talking about and discussing and trying to find out about these verses, this is madhmoon, this is reprehensible. It is not accepted. It is blameworthy. فَكَيْفَ يُعْتَدْ بِالْمُتَشَابِهَاتِ دَلِيلًا, if discussing these verses and going after these verses, if this is reprehensible like in the Quran, then how can we make mutashabihat and ambiguous verses as dalil? That's why he mentioned further that to even make our basis of shari'iyat, any of the commands on mutashabihat will not be accepted. And to make this evidence, mutashabihat, to make this evidence is a bid'ah, muhdatha, this is a new innovation, huwa al-haq, and this is the truth and reality. So according to Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah in al-i'tisam, to use mutashabihat, to use ambiguous verses, to prove one's aqidah, this is a bid'ah, this is an innovation. Now, those brothers that use these verses as in the literal meaning, they've gone to the extent that they have fallen inside tashbih, inside anthropomorphism, and they've given human qualities to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'll give you a few examples. By taking the literal meaning, they fall inside tashbih. Few examples. Here I have in front of me Majmu' al-Fatawa. Majmu' al-Fatawa, this is by Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah wa ta'ala. And inside volume number 2, on page 54, in the chapter of Kitab Mujmal I'tiqad al-Salaf, he has mentioned that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is free from body parts, a'adha. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is free from body parts, a'adha. A'adha means body parts. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is free from a'adha, body parts, but these body parts which Allah is free from is only the body parts of eating and drinking. Is the only the body parts of the eating and drinking. He's mentioned this under the verse of Mal Masih ibn Maryam illa Rasul, that Isa alayhi salam was only a prophet and many prophets have passed before him and his mother was truthful. Kana ya'kulani ta'am. They would both eat food. So he is refuting the Christians that eating food, this is not a sign of God. Eating food is not a sign of God. Then he further mentions that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is free from body parts which are used for akal and shurb, eating and drinking. But then he mentions Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not free from body parts that are used for actions. بِخِلَافِ الْيَدْ فَإِنَّهَا لِلْأَمْرِ وَالْفِعْلِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a'adha. Allah has body parts, but those body parts are used for actions, for fulfilling jobs. My brothers, you tell me now, is this the aqeedah of the Salaf? Imam Tahawi rahimahullah in his title is aqeedah, and many others have clearly stated that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is free from a'adha. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is free from body limbs and body parts. This is one example. Another example. In volume number seven, same fatawa of Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah. Allama Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah has mentioned regarding the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, regarding the arsh. And he has said regarding the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he's brought a few narrations. He's brought a narration regarding that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sitting on his throne. Yajlisu alayhi. Allah is sitting on his throne. And then he's mentioned that Allah, while sitting on his throne, he's left a space of four fingers all the way around. He has left the space of four fingers all the way around the arsh. And he's mentioned that that some ahli ahadith, i.e. the people of hadith, the people who have knowledge of the hadith, have mentioned that this hadith is weak. But then he mentioned, لَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ أَهْلِ السُنَّةِ قَبَلُوهُ. The majority of the Ahli Sunnah have accepted this hadith. Now I would like to ask a question to those brothers. That is this the true creed of the Sahaba? No. Is this the true creed of the Salaf? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sitting on the throne and he has left a space of four fingers? No. Then he further mentions that the most authentic opinion is that Allah is sitting on the throne. On page 483, we can look for our own, is in volume number 8, under the chapter of Kitab al-Tafsir, Min al-Zumar ilal-Masad. He mentions there that the most authentic opinion is that Allah is sitting on his arsh, but there is no space of four fingers. There is no space of four fingers. The reason Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah says this, that if we believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sitting on his throne and there is a space of four fingers, this will mean that the arsh is bigger than Allah. That the arsh is bigger than Allah. Therefore, we have to reject the narration where it says that the space of four fingers, and we'll have to accept the narration where the Prophet also mentioned that Allah is sitting on the arsh, but there is no space. I would like to ask a question down here. If Ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullahi alayhi is rejecting that hadith on the basis that the arsh will be bigger than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if we believe that he has left space, a gap of four fingers, then if there is no space and gap, what does that mean? The arsh and the Allah is
equal.
Is equal. Na'udhu billahi min dhalik. Another example I would like to give. This is again Majmu' al-Fatawa. I'm using the same book, different volumes. Volume number 3. Under the chapter of Kitab al-Asma wa Sifat, Imam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah has mentioned that there are many hadiths with the wording of qu'ud and julus regarding Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Many ahadiths with the word of julus and qu'ud, that Allah is literally sitting on his throne. This has been transmitted from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, like the hadith of Ja'far bin Abi Talib radiyallahu ta'ala, Umar ibn Khattab, and many other sahaba. Again, I would like to ask these brothers, who claim to follow the Salaf. That can they show me an authentic narration from the Prophet ﷺ and the Sahaba where the word Qu'udan Julus has come? Is this the Aqeedah of the Sahaba? Is this the Aqeedah of Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah? Is this the Aqeedah of Imam Bukhari rahimahullah? That Allah is sitting on his throne with the words Qu'udan Julus, like Imam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah has mentioned in his Fatawa, volume number 3. Further on, I would like to mention regarding Imam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah. Imam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah trying to prove this anthropomorphic aqidah in his Bayan wa Talbis al-Jahmiyyah, volume number 1, page 568. He went to the extent of saying, trying to prove that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sitting on the arsh, he has said, وَلَوْ شَاءَ لَاسْتَقَرَّ عَلَىٰ ظَهْرِ بَعُوضًا, that if Allah wanted and he wished, he can settle and sit on the back of a mosquito. This is written in Bayan al-Talbis al-Jahmiyyah. That if Allah wanted, he can sit and settle on the back of a mosquito. He can sit and settle on the back of a mosquito. Now my brothers, I ask you a question. Is this what the Salaf have said? Is this what our pious predecessors have said? He further mentions that if Allah can sit and settle on the back of a mosquito, why cannot he sit on an arsh which is bigger than the heavens and the earth? If Allah can sit and settle on the back of a mosquito, then arsh is very easy to do. فَكَيْفَ عَلَىٰ رَبْ عَرْشٍ عَظِيمٍ أَكْبَرْ مِنَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Some brothers criticize. They go around doing gush on the streets, asking people, where is Allah? A layman, a normal person, out of his jahl, he says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is everywhere. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is everywhere. And when he says Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is everywhere, I think we should ask for confirmation. I believe he doesn't mean that Allah is everywhere with his being. And I can inshallah guarantee this. He doesn't mean that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is everywhere with his being. When he says Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is everywhere, his knowledge is everywhere, his power is everywhere. And even if he does believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is everywhere with his being, then we should correct the brother. He's a layman under the day. It's our responsibility of being a Muslim that we tell him with wisdom and with love and affection. But this is a layman who's walking on the street today. Imam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala, who these people greatly respect, he has mentioned in his Al-Fatwa Al-Hamawiyyatul Kubra, page 79, that Allahu ma'ana hakikatan wa fawq al-arshi hakikatan. This is the side title, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with us literally. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with us literally, and he is on the arsh literally. So wherever we are, Allah is with us literally. And at the same time, He's on the earth literally. So what is their fatwa regarding this? What verdict will they give regarding Imam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah on this text? That Allahu ma'ana hakikatan, Allah is with us literally, and He's on the throne literally. Another example. My brothers, we don't want to expose Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, Imam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah. This is something we like to mention to those brothers who get very excited, attacking other people's aqidah. We would like to tell them that first, please look at your own house. Look at your own books and then come to it, inshallah ta'ala. Then inshallah, we will answer your questions. Imam Ibn Qayyim rahimullah, in his Ijtima' Julush al-Islamiyyah, in his very famous work, which these brothers, mashallah, are very fond of, and they will give you a lot of targheeb and advice, that brother, akhi, read this book. This book is very good in the chapter of Aqeedah. In Ijtima' Julush al-Islamiyyah, Hafiz Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah, this book is a book of Aqeedah, by the way. And we get criticized that, akhi, you use weak hadith. You use weak hadith in Fazail. I'm saying with basirat and tahaddi, with full conviction and challenge, that these people use fabricated ahadith inside aqidah. That these people use fabricated hadith inside aqidah. For example, Ijtima' Julush al-Islamiyyah, Hafiz Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah, he has mentioned al-hadith on the authority of Muslim Ahmad, which is regarding the intercession of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He has said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of judgment sitting on his throne, on his kursi. Jalisan, sitting on the throne. And he has said this narration is in Musnad Ahmad. This narration is in Sahih Musnad Ahmad. He has forged the word Jalis inside this hadith. The word Jalis doesn't exist anywhere inside Musnad Ahmad. Balki, their great scholar is supposed to be an exponent of the so-called Salafi creed has also alluded to this narration, the word Jalis inside his fatawa. Inside his fatawa, Majmu'ul Fatawa, volume number 1, page 135, he has also used this word Jalis. Now this is an open challenge, that can these brothers bring the word Jalis and sit in from the actual hadith of Musnad Ahmad? If they can't, and inshallah they will never, then what is the hukam and fatwa regarding that imam who has forged and fabricated a word inside the hadith related with aqidah? What is the hukum of that person who has forged a hadith and fabricated a hadith regarding aqidah? Further, going on further, another example. This is an example of all those people that have gone to the extreme in taking the literal meaning that they fall inside the tajsim. They have fallen inside anthropomorphism. Another example. This I have in front of me. Sharh al-Aqidah al-Wasatiyah. The actual matn and text, Aqidah al-Wasatiyah, is written by Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala. And the person and the scholar who has commentated on this hadith, on this Aqidah book, is Shaykh Muhammad bin Salih al-Uthaymeen. And this book is a book of Aqidah. And mashallah, the brothers, they read this book and they will recommend this book in the chapter of Aqidah. In this book, page 157, Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah, under the verse, فَأَيْنَمَا تُوَلُّوا فَثَمَّ وَجْبُ اللَّهِ فَأَيْنَمَا تُوَلُّوا فَثَمَّ وَجْبُ اللَّهِ. Wherever you turn, you will find the wajb of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You will find the verse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Under this, he has said that وَلَكِنَّ الصَّحِيحِ, that the most authentic opinion regarding the word wajh down here is أن المراد بالوجه هنا وجه الله الحقيقي, the literal face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The literal face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I will just show you just in case anyone has doubt. ولكن الصحيح أن المراد بالوجه هنا وجه الله الحقيقي. He said this is the most authentic narration, opinion, no evidence given. And that this is the most authentic opinion, that Allah's literal face everywhere. Now you tell me, isn't this worse than the layman who says Allah is everywhere? Isn't this worse than the layman who says Allah is everywhere? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when they say Allah is everywhere, at least they've said the whole being of Allah. This person is saying that the face only, the literal face is everywhere. Stop. So what is the fatwa regarding that person who inside the book of Aqidah, or that scholar who inside the book of Aqidah has said that wajh haqiqi, the literal face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is everywhere? Moving further, Shaykh bin Baz rahimahullah. These are a few examples. There are many examples, but because of lack of time, inshallah, I will try my best to give a few examples. Shaykh bin Baz rahimahullah, in his book تنبيهات في الرد على من تأول الصفات, on page 69, he has mentioned, while refuting Sheikh Sabuni, that Sheikh Sabuni has mentioned that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is free from body, he is free from an eye, he is free from an ear drum, he is free from a tongue, lisan. He is free from all these things. Because all of the scholars have agreed on the transcendence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from body part. But Shaykh bin Baz further mentions, هذا ليس بمذهب أهل السنة. This is not the madhab of the Ahli Sunnah. This is the madhab of the Ahli Kalam, which is reprehensible. Why? Because These things have been established by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, we believe in this. Now I ask, has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala got a tongue? Like Ibn Baz rahimahullah is saying. Has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala got a literal eye? Like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like he is mentioning. He says, we only deny what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has denied for himself. We only deny what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has denied for himself. Don't we deny all deficiencies for Allah? Don't we deny all shortness for Allah? لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ Do we only have to deny those things which are mentioned in the Quran? If we're going to use this principle, then I ask Shaykh bin Baz rahimahullah and those that follow him. May Allah have mercy on him, he has passed away. Those that follow him and those that propagate his aqidah, I would like to ask them a question. If we're going to use this catchphrase, that we'll only establish what Allah has established for himself, and we'll only deny what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has denied for himself, then will we deny illness for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Can we deny hunger for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Can we deny thirst for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hasn't denied none of this inside the Quran. Of course, this is absurd. Moving further, Shaykh Fawzan, hafizahullah, he has also mentioned the same thing as Shaykh bin Baz rahimahullah, that nowhere in the Quran and Hadith وَلَمْ يَرِدْ نَفْيُ الْجِسْمُ الشَّكْرِ Nowhere in the Quran and Hadith has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam denied a body or appearance for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because we only deny what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has denied for himself. Subhanallah. Again, I ask these people, shall we deny hunger for Allah? Shall we deny thirst for Allah? Shall we deny illness for Allah? Why? We can't, because nowhere in the Quran Allah has denied these things. But it's absurd for a Muslim to even imagine that Allah can be in. It's absurd for a Muslim to even imagine that Allah can become thirsty. This is also absurd for a Muslim to imagine that Allah has got a body. That's why Imam Al-Allama Sayfullah ala ru'usil mulhideen, Imam Razi rahimullah has mentioned that a mujassim, an anthropomorphist, he never worships Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because he only worships the surah and the appearance inside his brain, and Allah is free from the surah and appearance.
Allahu Akbar. Subhanallah.
Inshallah ta'ala, we will prove the aqidah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba and the Salaf al-Saliheen and the Aima Arba all the way down to Ulama'i Dioban, Mawlana Ashraf al-Thami rahimahullah, Mawlana Qasim Nanuti rahmatullahi alayhi, Mawlana Zakariya rahimahullah wa ta'ala, Shaykh Allama Khalil Ahmad Sarampuri rahmatullahi alayhi, Shaykh Zakariya rahmatullahi alayhi, Shaykh al-Ajim wal-Arab, Allama Anwar Shah Kashmir rahmatullahi alayhi. Inshallah, all these people's, their aqidah will be proven from the Quran, Hadith, Ijma' and the course of the Salaf. But moving further, the literal meaning that these people take, that we take the meaning in the literal sense, I would like to ask them a question. If they take the hand, for example, if they take the hand in the literal meaning, the word haqiqi means?
Literal.
Haqiqi, literal. Now there's two types of haqiqi. There's two types of?
Haqiqi.
One haqiqi which is opposing to majaz. One haqiqi which is opposing to majaz, metaphorical. In usuli fiqh, in the principle of jurisprudence, many students here who are studying usuli shashi, they will know that there is haqiqi and there is one opposed to haqiqi, which means
majaz,
metaphorical meaning. And the second type of haqiqi is which is from haq. Haqiqi from haq. And haq means the truth. And haq, like Imam Ibn Mandur rahimahullah has mentioned in his Lisan al-Arab, the haqiqi from haq means thabat, i.e. to be established. So if they say, akhi, we believe haqiqi to be haq, i.e. the truth, and thabata is established, then we have no problem. Because even we believe that the words are established, the ahadith are established, and they are true from Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But if they say, no, we believe haqiqi, i.e. from literal, which is opposed to majaz, then that's where they go wrong. Because in the Arabic language, you only have the haqiqi meaning for the in the Arabic language. Whoever whichever dictionary you pick is a body limb which has fingers and is made of blood and
flesh.
And thus where they will fall inside tajseem and anthropomorphism. Moving further, that taking the literal meaning, we cannot take the literal meaning. It's impossible to take the literal meaning. What we are told to take is the literal words. There's two things here. There's one zahir lafz and there's one zahir ma'na. The apparent words and apparent meaning. We are commanded to have iman on the apparent words. We are commanded to have iman on the apparent
words.
Not on the apparent meaning. This is where many brothers go wrong. We have iman. This is allegation on the Ahl Sunnah that we don't take and believe in the words. We have iman. وَالرَّاسِخُونَ فِي الْعِلْمِ يَقُولُونَ آمَنَّا بِهِ. Those have sound knowledge, they say we have iman. We have iman and accept the words. The apparent words. But we do not accept the apparent meaning. Why? We consign the meaning. We consign the meaning. And we relegate the meaning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala regarding the sifat, sifatul khabariyya. Imam Khatabi rahimullah has mentioned, this has been transmitted in Aqabir al-Thiqat, page 174. Imam Khatabi rahimullah has mentioned that our shuyukh, where he's mentioned the hadith regarding the shin of Allah, هذا الحديث مما تهيب القول في شيوخنا. That our scholars, they are afraid to speak regarding this hadith. When Allah has mentioned the saq, his shin. فَأَجْرُوهُ عَلَى ظَاهِرِ لَفْزِهِ. They've all accepted the ظاهر لفظ. They have all accepted the ظاهر لفظ. And none of them have accepted the ظاهر meaning. بلكي they have consigned the meaning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
يا حامل القرآن